God bless. I'm Pastor Chris Fryer, pastor of Victorious Believers Ministry and board member of the Victorious Community Development. We're excited about what God is doing in the city of Saginaw, and I'm asking you to be a part of it. For over 24 years, Victorious Community Development has both actively led and supported successful community-based programs to meet the needs of Saginaw residents. As the needs of those we serve continue to evolve, we too must adapt and adjust. The programs offered by Victorious Community Development, our focus on creating and improving social, economic, and social cultural wellness in the Saginaw community. I'm yet excited about the future of Saginaw and the Great Lakes Bay region and how God is restoring our city. God has given us the vision. We are building a community where our families are empowered and inspired. I see a community of young people and families joining together successfully and achieving their goals. Over the last 3 years, God has made the assignment clear to me and the purpose of Victorious Community Development to be the hands and the feet of Jesus Christ to make sure that we not only love this community, but we serve this community. The Mel A. Pryor Community Development Center is named after Mel Pryor, my late brother, who faithfully served families and mentored youth in this community for over 20 years before he passed. He was truly the type of person who inspired people to make things happen. And we are elated to honor his legacy of servant leadership in this way. The Word of God is our guide for how we navigate the challenges of life and to live in the favor of God, even during difficult times. In Matthew 24:7, the scripture forewarns us that in the last days, nations shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilence and earthquakes in diverse places. Our job as the hands and the feet of Jesus Christ is to remember the marginalized and those in need. Our drive-through food pantry seeks to greatly expand our existing indoor food pantry program by allowing us to better serve those in the Saginaw County and the surrounding area who are in need of groceries and other household essentials. Individuals and families will be able to pick up free food without leaving their vehicle, which makes it possible to serve more individuals more frequently. Just this year, we have already served over 5,000 families. At minimum, we anticipate serving 10,000 families a year if we had a larger facility and more store space where we could be available to the public more frequently. I believe that our assignment as the church is to have the foresight and the insight to prepare people for what's to come, as Joseph did for his family and all of Egypt in Genesis, the 47th chapter. This is why we're building a hydroponics garden that will allow us the capability to grow fresh fruit and vegetables all year round in our community. During a time when there will be limited access to produce, the church will be able to help feed families both naturally and spiritually. In addition, we are helping to close the COVID gap in our schools by building a state-of-the-art, cutting-edge educational facility that will give low to middle income students the opportunity to learn the skills needed to both excel and complete academically on an unprecedented level. This facility truly puts the fun in learning by providing students with a plethora of educational methods that cater to diverse learning styles. We are hiring local educators to facilitate the study sessions and to tutor and mentor our children. During a time when the world has given up on our children, the church is stepping in. We believe in making things happen. By empowering the children to reach their dreams, we are strengthening our community and building for the future. Children who have a loving, caring adult in their life are less likely to engage in violence, plus exposure to a sense of purpose and creativity helps them embrace their unique God-given identity. It's a game changer. Did you know that in some areas of our city, residents have to travel miles away from home to find a grocery store with quality, affordable fresh fruits and vegetables for their families? Soon that will no longer be the case. Mel Anthony Pryor Marketplace will be a discounted volunteer-run grocery store program, ensuring that hardworking families and individuals are able to purchase the food and supplies they need, regardless of income or other barriers. Last, but certainly not least, health prevention education is vital to ensuring that families, seniors, and individuals are aware of the steps needed to take the best care of themselves, as well as the community resources available to them. The Mel Anthony Pryor Community Development Center will provide resources for preventative care and health screens to the most vulnerable populations. It will also be the home of the newest small business in our city as we encourage entrepreneurship and sustainability as essential components of economic development in Saginaw. Can you see it? I mean, really, can you really see it? Eyes haven't seen, ears haven't heard, neither has it entered the heart of man what God has in store, but it's been revealed by the Spirit of God. I'm asking you to partner with us. God is up to something great and you're a part of it. Join in with the vision. As a matter of fact, you can go to govcd.org to find out more of what God is doing for the city. He's given us the keys and it's time for the church to take his rightful place. With you partnering with me, watch what God will do. As my brother would say, make things happen. I love you and God bless you.
All right. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Victorious Believers Ministries, where everybody is somebody, and we are glad to have you here. This evening, we will be presenting our Black History Program, where we will be celebrating and honoring our ancestors for what they've done. Now, at this time, can I please have everybody stand on your feet for a moment of prayer? All right, everybody, bow your heads and close your eyes. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for providing us with another day of living, especially on this fourth day of Black History Month, where we celebrate our ancestors for what they've done by paving the way for us, Lord. We ask you to bless our keynote speaker today, Lord. Our justice. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. And we ask you to bless our keynote speaker, the first Black female justice of Michigan Supreme Court. Her name being Justice Kyra Harris Bolden, Lord. We ask you to bless her, not to only bless her, but to bless her entirely, Lord, as well as everybody else in this program, Lord, whether they're singing, dancing, or reading a poem, Lord. We ask you to bless them, Lord. Bless them entirely, as well as everybody else that got her upon today, to this day, Lord. We ask you, Lord, to bless us here and as well as the ones online, Lord. We ask you to bless us entirely, Lord. And also to thank you again, Lord, for blessing us to not only have a day, but a month to honor our ancestors for what they did for us, Lord. I think about Dr. Martin Luther King and what he said in his final speech. I've been to the mountaintop. Lord, he says this. So, I'm happy tonight. I am not worried about anything. I am not fearing any man. My eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. And with this reminds me to one of my favorite verses in the Bible, Lord. It reminds me of Psalms chapter 118, verse 6, where it says, the Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do unto me? We celebrate tonight, and I am so happy to take part to pray for you to bless tonight, Lord. We thank you, and we also celebrate one of the greats in my time, the great Bishop Marvin C. Pratt. As I echo his words that he left us for our legacy, that salvation plus education equals success. We thank you, Lord, and we will celebrate our heritage tonight. Amen, amen, and amen.
Proverbs 4, verse 5 through 9, from the New Living Translation. Get wisdom, develop good judgment, Don't forget my words or turn away from them. Don't turn your back on wisdom, for she will protect you. Love her and she will guard you. Getting wisdom is the wisest thing you can do. And whatever else you do, develop good judgment. If you prize wisdom, she will make you great. Embrace her and she will honor you. She will place a lovely wealth on your head. She will present you with a beautiful crown.
Come on, stand to your feet as we worship him. Come on, you can put your hands together and give God a praise. We're going to lift up the name of Jesus because we know that he is worthy. Come on, if you know that he's worthy to receive glory and honor, I need you to put your hands together and give him a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. praise him. I need to see him praising him. Yeah, we're gonna praise you, Lord. Praise you,
Lord. I gotta get this right. Oh my gosh. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears. Yes. Oh man. This is such a big moment. I'm trying to get the words right. Lord, help me. Oh. Okay. All right. Well, this is going to be such a monumental moment for us in our little school here. Booker T. Washington is coming to our school, and they've asked me to write this poem, and God, the words are coming, but I just can't get the cadence down to this poem. I can't get it to flow right, and man, I'm struggling with this.
How's the poem going, man? Oh,
little bro, I'm struggling. I got the words, but the flow of it is just not working for me. But I'm a poet. This is what I do. I should be able to just put this together, and it's just not coming together. I mean, what do you think? What do you think? You've heard me say it a couple of times. Does it belong as a poem, or?
I think we should get our big sister to, you know what I'm saying?
So you think maybe we should make it a song? I don't know. But let me hear what you got. What kind of melody you thinking? Huh. All right. Slow tempo. It might work. But let's get Big Sis in here. Maybe she can help us. Since I'm struggling with this song, why don't you take a look? Tell me what you think.
Lift every voice and sing.
Okay.
Till earth and heaven ring.
Ooh.
Ring with a harp. What do you think?
You know? It's got a ring to it.
Yeah, I think everybody should sing it.
Yeah.
Come on, everybody join us.
Most of you know that song went on to become the Black National Anthem. As a matter of fact, myself, James Weldon Johnson, was a principal at a school in Jacksonville writing a poem for Booker T. Washington. And my brother put that poem to music, and our children sang the song for Booker T. Washington. Little did I know, me and my brother moved to New York City, and we were writing Broadway plays. But that song resounded as loud as the roaring seas. That song began to take its own life as the children continued to sing it. And little did I know that it began to grow nationally. And I was in New York, and that song was gaining a life of itself. And people began to sing it, and the NAACP adopted it as the National Negro Anthem. That was before the United States of America even had an anthem. At that time, I joined the NAACP, and I began to provide services and help to forge and fight for the civil rights of black and brown people. They say that the pen is mightier than the sword. And I believe that's true, because the impact of the laws that we can put in place by our vote and our representation goes much farther than the violence that anyone can ever imagine. And as we stand today, we still need that pen, and we still need our voice. Our vote is our voice. Our vote is what will change the laws that are in place that do not favor us, that keep us oppressed. Our voice in our community holds power. When we're thinking about our black young men and women that are dying in the streets to violence, it is us that need to stand up and be the voice of the community for change. With that being said, we have strides to make, but we have made great strides. The voices are rising. People that look like us are sitting at the tables. They're making the decisions. All we need is more of those faces and voices. Amen. With that being said, I'm going to introduce to you our MC for this evening, one voice that is at a table, Councilman Minister George Copeland. Let's put our hands together. Right.
Good evening, everyone. I know this is our Black History Service, but we're in church, so I'm going to say praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, saints and friends. Welcome to Victorious Believers Ministries. We are excited to have you this evening for our Embracing Our Heritage and Educating the Next Generation. Tonight, I will tell you this program is full of great encouragement. The one thing I enjoy about when we come together as a people, we may be downtrodden when we start off, but by the time we leave, we're all going to be uplifted. So today, we have some great people that will be with us this evening. And one thing we want to start off, this past summer, I had the opportunity to travel to Ghana. And I'm going to encourage everyone, that is one of our life goals, to get back to the motherland and to at least put your feet and your hands on in Africa. And one of the things I learned is most times in American education, when we talk about black history, we talk about the impact of slavery and we talk about what happened after slavery, but we do not spend as much time talking about who we were as a people before the chains. And so tonight we are going to start off with that presentation. What was life like for Africans before slavery? So tonight we have Sister Rhonda Farrell Butler, who will present on life before slavery, a pre-slavery presentation. And following her, we will be having a dance ministry by our own VBM God Chasers. Let's welcome Miss Butler at this time.
Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place throughout all generations. What a blessing it is to be here today. I want to thank you for inviting me to participate and take part. I was praying, so pray with me. I have had a horrible respiratory problem. So I told my mom, she said, I know you're not going up there with those papers. I said, I have no choice. So she so I'm going to try to make it work all the way. To Pastor Pryor, to Lady Pryor, so good to see you today. To our wonderful speaker, my sister in Greek, Representative O'Neill, Senator Kristen Rivett, to Judge Janie Lamar, and to all of the dignitaries. I told Gwen, I said, oh, there's so many dignitaries in here. I don't want to, you know, make nobody feel bad. So everybody's important. Give yourselves a hand. Thank you. But I must thank the official staff of this great church, the officers, the coordinator of the program, Sister Buffalo, and her committee. Thank you again. I want to creatively share my thoughts about the African experience prior to American slavery. Poetry is something that I love, and I feel that's the best way for me to tell my story. It is a well-known opinion that Africa is the birthplace of all humankind. If you believe in a single origin of human beings, and we do as Christians, then know that it is biblically and scientifically validated that the first humans probably originated somewhere in Africa. Africa is the second largest continent and is the most diverse by virtue of having more distinct countries, 54, than any other continent. Africa is a continent that had and still has many kings and queens. Africa has 40% of the world's gold and up to 90% of its chromium and platinum. The world's largest reserves of cobalt, diamonds, platinum, and uranium, it's all in Africa. I believe the greatest resource that the African continent has mass-produced to transform the world is the enslaved African. The byproduct of the presence of enslaved Africans throughout the diaspora is rich culture, creativity, and innovation. Our African ancestors passed down traditions to us through the oral tradition. Joseph E. Holloway edits a book entitled That Africanism in American Culture, where he describes Africanism as practices, traditions, stories, music, medicine cures, food traditions, superstitions, words, and more that can be attributed to African origins. These words such as banana, jazz, boogie, they're all Africa. So let me use my poetry to share why I believe it is important for us to acknowledge our African origins, especially during this month, Black History Month. I am an African. Not because I was born there, but because my heart, it beats with Africa's. I am an African. Not because my skin is black, but because my mind is engaged by Africa. I am an African. Not because I live on its soil, but because my home is in Africa. When Africa weeps for her children, my cheeks are stained with tears. When Africa honors its elders, my head is bowed in respect. When Africa mourns for her victims, my hands are joined in prayer. When Africa celebrates her triumphs, my feet are alive with dancing. I am an African, for her blue skies take my breath away, and my hope for the future is bright. I am an African, for her people greet me as family, and they teach me the meaning of community. I am an African, for her wildness quenches my spirit and brings me closer to the source of life. When the music of Africa beats in the wind, my blood pulses to its rhythm, and I become the essence of sound. When the colors of Africa dazzle in the sun, my senses drink in its rainbow, and I become the palette of nature. When the stories of Africa echo round the fire, my feet, they walk in its pathways, and I become the footprints of history. I am an African because she is the cradle of our birth and nurtures an ancient wisdom. And won't you say it with me? I am a, because she is the land of tomorrow, and I recognize her gifts as sacred. Enslaved Africans endured what many would call some of the most known offenses against human civilization. Enslaved Africans emerged from 400 years of slavery and decades of ongoing and continuing modern-day racism. Black people, the descendants of enslaved Africans, they have still managed to keep love in our hearts. I believe that is why this makes the African soul so very special. I would like to conclude with this last poem written by Rain Visser. And I'd like to conclude it as a prayer. Because as we pray for America, how can we not pray for Africa? Would you join me? God bless Africa, for she is the seed of humanity, and I am the future through her. When her roots sprout, I am born, and as her leaves unfurl, I grow. When her branches spread, I learn, and as her flowers bud, I bloom. God bless Africa, for she is the fire of creation, and I am transformed through her. When problems loom, I am challenged, and when solutions hide, I search. When suffering strikes, I ache, and when relief calls, I answer. God bless Africa, for she is the tree of life, and I am alive through her. When her roots are dry, I thirst, and when her trunk is cut, I bleed. As the seasons turn, I change, and as her fruits ripen, I flourish. God bless Africa. Thank you.
Let's give it up for our God chasers again. Let's give it up for them one more time. Thank God for the dancing and the colors. It's just a beautiful thing. I love to see. One of the things that I forgot to say when I got up earlier and giving you your greetings is akwaba. Akwaba. So that is the one thing we learned in Ghana. When you go to Ghana, wherever you go, you will hear, say it with me, akwaba. Akwaba. All it means is you're welcome. So we want you to know that here this evening, you all are welcome. We have all of our dignitaries that will be honored and greeted later on. But what I want us to do right now, I am here to give you all a warning. One thing about the Pentecostal church is we're a loud church. So if you don't allow loud music, don't come to a Pentecostal church, because we're going to be loud. But today, we're going to be a little louder, okay? So this is my warning to you. If you need some toilet tissue, put it in here now. Because who we have coming up next, they're going to make some noise. Tonight, we have the Saginaw High Arthur Hill Drum Line. So what after our drum line, I will be back up. So if you can, stand on your feet and welcome the Saginaw High and Arthur Hill Drumline.
Good afternoon, Victoria believers. We're so very glad to be here. My name is Jordan Edwards. I'm the band director of Saginaw United Marching Band Music Department. Thank you. This particular group is called the Saginaw United Drumline. We don't go by Saginaw High anymore. We don't go by Arthur Hill anymore. We are Saginaw High School. And I know you've seen that beautiful building being built downtown, and we're going to be able to move in next fall, so we're going to have a nice send-off then. We're here to celebrate our Black heritage with a little bit of thing about African drumming. The one thing that we as Black men and Black women have contributed to this planet is our music. Drumming has been around since man has been around, but I want to throw something out at you. Who can tell me what is the oldest instrument known to man? I bet you nobody knows. I hear drums. Believe it or not, it's not the drums. It's actually the human voice. We could sing before we can beat. We can do that. Drums came a little bit later. I'm going to talk about that right now, hand drums and African experience. African drums are so iconic of Africa that an African drummer is almost a stereotype. The fact that drums have been an intrinsic part of African life for countless generations, to an extent that is probably beyond the grasp of non-Africans. It's generally accepted that Africa is the cradle of humanity. So it's not unreasonable to conclude that music from a part of the African experience before many, if not all, other civilizations were even born. Music is deeply woven into the fabric of African life, and drums are the primordial musical instrument. Drums play an important role in every aspect of African life, including physical, emotional, and spiritual, throughout their collective unconsciousness. It is the genes of the drum life of Africa. Drums are inseparable from the African culture. They help define it, so much that when the slave trade scattered Africans throughout the world, the love of drumming they took with them irrevocably altered the world of music. What we have here today, and we were fortunate at Saginaw High School to have an African drum that I want to show you. If you don't mind, Ivan, would you raise that drum up a little bit? That is called a djembe. It is a skin-covered goblet drum played with bared hands. It's originally from West Africa. According to the Bambara people in Mali, the name of djembe comes from the saying Anke Dije, Anke Bay, which translates to everyone gathered together in peace and defines the drum's purpose. In the Bambara language, Dije is the verb for gather and Bay translate as peace. So African drumming was an instrument of peace. It's also an instrument of war. It's also an instrument of fun. It's also an instrument of sorrow. Ivan Phillips is going to play just a little bit of that drum so you can hear the sound of it. Hey, Ivan. As he plays, it uses polyrhythms. Polyrhythms that you sometimes you would play triplets, sometimes you would play eighth notes, 16th notes. Thank you. That is a demonstration of the djembe. Thank you so much. At this time, I'll turn it over to the drum line, and they will play a feature for you.
Let's give it up for the Saginaw United Drumline. Where's Brother Edwards? Brother Edwards, you had to show him something. You had to show him you were first of all, service of all. We shall transcend all. Amazing job, amazing job. Saginaw United Drumline. Let's give it up for them one more time. Now that we are awake, let's keep it going, all right? We will continue on in this great celebration. We will have a poem coming by Sister Maya Johnson, who is a part of the VBM Youth Ministry. And following Sister Johnson, we will have a dance in Black history by the is this the Saginaw High or the Saginaw United step team? All right, Saginaw High step team. I want to get it right. Our board president was getting me over here. Our board of education president was getting me. So it is the Saginaw High step team. So after Sister Johnson, let's receive Saginaw High.
Good afternoon. My name is Maya Johnson, and I am a freshman at Carleton High School. Today I was asked to read a poem. My poem is entitled, Won't You Celebrate With Me, written by Lucille Clifton. Won't you celebrate with me what I have shaped into a kind of life? I had no motto. Born in Babylon, both non-white and woman, what did I see to be except myself? I made it up. Here on this bridge between starshine and clay, my one hand holding tight my other hand. So come and celebrate with me that every day something has tried to kill me and failed. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you for having us here, y'all. I was running a little bit, so I got to catch my breath. My name is Keandria Brown, and I'm a teacher at Saginaw High, and I'm also blessed enough to be one of the coaches of the Saginaw High dance and step team. Excuse me, y'all. So we are grateful to be a part of this program today. We are actually ecstatic to be here with you guys. And so I'm just going to give you a little history about step. Step was first introduced to America in the late 19th century when freed slaves brought their traditions with them from West Africa. Step is a form of dance that combines sounds and movements to create a powerful performance. Within our presentation, the team is ready to utilize our gifts of dance and stepping to worship God. So again, I want to introduce to you all the Saginaw High Trojans dance and step team, and we're grateful for you all having us here today.
Sing low, sweet chariot, coming forth to carry me. Won't you let me ride? Oh,
swing down, chariot, stop and let me ride. Oh, rock me, Lord, rock me, Lord. Come and easy,
I got a home.
I got a home on the other side.
Oh, six white horses standing side by side. Oh, swing.
Six white horses present side by side. Oh, rock me, Lord, rock me, Lord. Come and easy.
let me ride, oh swing.
Swing now, Cherry, stop and let me ride, oh rock me, Lord, rock me, Lord. Lord. Hey, 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 hey. I got a home on the other side.
Got a home.
I got a home.
You got a home.
I got a home.
We got a home.
I got a home.
I got a home.
I got home.
We going home.
I got home.
Going home.
I got home.
There's a light, sweet light, sweet chariot. Take me home. Take me home.
I'm going.
I'm going.
Home.
Bunga Lafia.
Ashe, ashe. Ashe, ashe.
Seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land.
For those of you that think that gospel music has gone too far, you think we've gotten too radical with our message. Well, I got news for you. You ain't heard nothing yet. And if you don't know, now you know. Glory, glory! Woo! You better put them hands together and act like you know up in here. Cheap Pete!
All right, let's give it up for our Saginaw High Steppers. Are there any Trojans in the house? Any Trojans? All right. Any lumberjacks in the house? Now y'all gotta do better than that. The Trojans out here showing out. I just wanted to make sure to do that. And then I also see some Divine Nine. Ms. Butler said it earlier. Is there any Divine Nine in the crowd tonight? All right. 1-1-1-1-9. Yes, sir. All right, let's go. It is time to give. Amen. So tonight, we are going to sow into our house. We're thankful that those who are here. We're just going to do a love offering. And if you can, I know we have some additional things that are going on, but we have a few ways to give. They'll put it on the screen. If you would like to sow tonight during our video announcements, you will hear some of the new projects that are going on at Victorious Believers Ministries, and everything that we sow, it is going into good ground to serve our community. And so I won't go too much into it, but we have multiple ways to give tonight, and I think they're going to be able to put that on the screen. You can give by Givelify. If you have the app, you can look up Victorious Believers Ministries. You can give on our website. You can also, there we go. We have multiple ways to give. When I say multiple, all right? But thank you all of those who will be willing to give and sow seeds tonight into the house of God. But I would ask for everyone, if you can, stand with me at this time as we pray over the offering. And our deacons are coming at this time. And before we pray over the offering, we here at Victorious Believers, we have a declaration over our seed. And so you can just repeat after me. Dear Lord, thank you that the same power that raised you from the dead lives inside of me. Because of this, I know that I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. I pray that today I will be surrounded by your favor, and that no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Thank you for going ahead of me and making the crooked places straight and the rough places smooth. Father, open for me, opportunity for me that no man can shut. I thank you in advance that my life will be blessed so that I can be a greater blessing to others. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you today. And there shall be no lack in this house, and there shall be no lack in my house. And there shall be an abundance in this house, and there shall be an abundance in my house. Gracious Father, we thank you for the declaration of abundance. As we are here tonight commemorating and celebrating the life and what the works of African Americans, a story of endurance, a story of testimonies. Father, thank you that we are the seed of those who endure. So Father, as we sow our seed to continue to go into our community, to serve, to help the lost, those who are widowed, those who are without. Father, we ask those that are giving that you will bless their homes, that this will be a time of abundance for them, that 2024 will be a great year of abundance, that there shall be no lack in their house, and there shall be abundance. So Father, we honor you and we give you all the glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. And so right now, before we move, I'm going to give you some instructions. You are going to follow the directions of our ushers, but following myself, we will have our own attorney, Glennis Talley, who will come and introduce our speaker. Following our introduction, we will have CMU Gospel Choir, who will have an AMB selection, so they will be able to come and get ready now. And following that, we will be in the hands of our guest speaker, Justice Kyra Harris Bolden. You are now in the hands of our ushers, and following, we are in the hands of our video announcements.
And God bless you, Victorious Believers Ministries. These are your church announcements and VBM upcoming events. To all of our guests, friends, and family, Pastor Chris, First Lady Kenyatta, and co-founder Evangelist Ruth C. Pryor, along with the entire VBM Nation, want you to know how very humbled and grateful we are for you choosing to worship with us both in person and virtually. Welcome to the Victorious Life Worship Experience. We want to extend a great welcome and thank you for joining us for today's Black History Celebration as we honor Black excellence, past, present, and future. We are embracing our heritage and educating the next generation. VBM extends a warm and heartfelt welcome to our dynamic special guest, Justice Kyra Harris Bolden, and to all of our dignitaries, community leaders, business owners, neighbors, and friends who are with us today. Save the date for our 30th annual Prayer and Praise Breakfast at Horizons Conference Center on Saturday, March 2nd. This is the time each year where civic leaders and community members come together for a special time of prayer for the prosperity of our city. The theme for this year is Communities Built to Last, inspired by our very own co-founder, Evangelist Ruth C. Pryor, and her new book, Built to Last, which is scheduled to be released soon. As the founder of the Prayer Breakfast and the organizer for over two decades, we are honored that Evangelist Pryor will be the keynote speaker for this momentous occasion. Tickets are available for a $40 donation. See any woman of excellence to purchase your tickets. And calling all business owners, in-person vendor space is also available. The cost is only $100 for VBM members and $125 for non-members. Both prices include a prayer breakfast ticket. You can also be a digital vendor for $35 for VBM members and $50 for non-members. In this regard, prayer breakfast tickets will not be included. Victorious Community Development is on the move and making great progress with the development of the Mel A. Pryor Community Development Center. This new facility will be a beacon of hope in the Saginaw community and will transform the lives of youth and families. Plans are already in motion to build a state-of-the-art educational facility, discount grocery store, hydroponics garden, and a food pantry with community engagement spaces for health prevention services. There are lots of ways for community members to volunteer and get involved. Find out more about the work we're doing and how we can partner together at www.govcd.org. Now, we invite you to download the VBM Church app to stay tuned to all events, updates, weekly announcements, as well as download sermon notes and much more. For a repeat of today's announcements, or if you have questions regarding any of the events mentioned, simply visit our website at www.victoriousbelievers.com for a complete listing of upcoming events and services, or call the church office at 989-755-7692. Finally, you can always find out what's going on at the VBM on social media. Check us out, follow us, subscribe to us, and like us, because we absolutely, positively love you. Well, I certainly hope you found this week's announcements both informative and enjoyable. And remember, here at Victorious Believers Ministries, our mission is to passionately seek God, joyfully serve others, and intentionally love people. I'm Elder Tom Harvey, your church announcer, wishing you and yours a wonderful, safe, and prosperous week. Until next time, continue to live the victorious life. Now, as you already know, February is dedicated to the celebration of Black History. Stay tuned for a special Black History presentation.
Black History Month is a commemoration, vocab word, for Black activists, another vocab word,
who took their time out to go fight for what they feel is right. Like
Martin Luther King had a speech that violence is not the answer and no segregation.
We celebrate Black people that helped us change history.
It reminds us to be strong, even in politics. Wait.
What matters is what's inside of you and how you act to other people.
Doesn't matter if you're Black, if you're white, just always celebrate it because you know the struggles Black leaders went through in order for you to be here right now.
even though we may have the different skin color, we're still the same type of people, no matter what.
And a lot of people, they don't see me for who I am. They see my outside appearance, but they don't see what I have on the inside.
It's very hard to grow up knowing that you're Black and you have a lot of personal prejudice against you.
I see it on the TV and I'm like, is that gonna happen to my brother? Is that gonna happen to my dad? I always have that in the back of my mind every time that I'm home and they're not home.
Black history is important to me because I have to remember where I came from and I have to remember who came before me.
Because you have to look at the things that Martin Luther King Jr., Rosa Parks, and Malcolm X did for us Black people, so people can't treat us unfairly because they think some type of belief.
Because we are all people and we need to stand up for our rights.
There's still discrimination. There's still discrimination in all parts of the world, in all parts of the United States. We should still fight for what we believe in. We should still fight for getting what's right.
Good afternoon. Justice Kyra Harris Bolden joined the Michigan Supreme Court when she was appointed by Governor Gretchen Whitmer on January 1st, 2023, making her the first Black woman to serve as a justice. A graduate of Southfield Public Schools, Justice Bolden chose to remain in Michigan for her studies, receiving her bachelor's degree from Grand Valley State University and Juris Doctor from the University of Detroit Mercy School of Law. After becoming a member of the state bar, Justice Bolden practiced as a criminal defense attorney. She then served as a judicial law clerk in Wayne County's Third Circuit Court and practiced as a civil litigation attorney before joining the Michigan legislature in 2019. While serving in the Michigan House of Representatives, Bolden advocated for Michiganders as a member of the Judiciary Committee and focused her work on criminal justice reform and crafting and passing bipartisan legislation to protect survivors of sexual violence. Alongside her daily work, Justice Bolden is an active member of her community, serving as a member of the Oakland County Bar Association, Wolverine Bar Association, Straker Bar Association, the Women Lawyers Association of Michigan, National Congress of Black Women, Oakland County, and Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, Incorporated. Justice Bolden has received several awards, including the 2019 Detroit Association of Women's Clubs, Incorporated Young Women Lifting as We Climb Image Award, the 2019 African American Leadership Awards Emerging Leader Award, and a 2020 Michigan Chronicle 40 Under 40 Award. Justice Bolden is the proud wife of Dr. Greg Bolden and the mother to daughter Emerson Bolden. Following the CMU Gospel Choir, please join me in welcoming Justice Kyra Harris Bolden.
Good afternoon, everyone. We are Christ Central Choir for Central Michigan University. And we just want to thank you guys for having us, and I hope you enjoy us.
What if he
Bye. Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for inviting me here, Pastor and Lady Pryor. Thank you. We've been trying to do this for a while, and I'm so excited that we were able to get this together. And thank you all for having me. I really appreciate it. I was just telling Pastor, I feel like this whole program has just kind of been my life, and I know you're wondering how. So I can't sing, so I'm sorry to the singers. But everything else, I was a competitive dancer growing up. I actually was a percussionist. I was in the band. And I was on a step team as a member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated. So I was just really enjoying this program. Thank you so much for putting it all together. So I was asked here to speak about my journey to the Michigan Supreme Court. I know some of you are wondering how a 34-year-old made her way to be the first black woman on the Michigan Supreme Court. So I'm going to share my story with you, if that's okay. But before I do that, I do want to acknowledge some people in the room and some that are not in the room. So I served in the legislature, which I will talk about. And I served with my good friend, State Representative Amos O'Neill. So thank you, my friend. It's been a pleasure getting to know you. I also served with your clerk, Vanessa Guerra. And I know she wasn't able to be here, but we did speak. And I didn't get to serve with Senator Kristen Rivett McDonald, but congratulations. And I know that Dr. Pam Pugh is here as well. She's the president of the State Board of Ed. And because I am now a justice, I always like to acknowledge the judges in the room. So if you are a judge, I want you to stand up. Come on, judges. Come on, magistrates, judges. Thank you. Because sometimes we forget about the judicial branch, right? We're a whole branch of government, very important. So I grew up in Southfield, Michigan. And I always start with that, and why that's so important is because, quite frankly, I grew up around black people. Southfield is 70-80% black, and when I grew up, I saw people that looked like me as judges, as lawyers. My parents' accountant was black. I go to the grocery store and see black people, business owners. And so to be honest, I took for granted representation. I'm just gonna be honest with you. Because everyone around me that looked like me was in positions of power and thriving, right? So I went to Grand Valley State University. I know, we're rivals here. We talked about it. We have the president of Saginaw Valley here. We talked about it. But I learned several lessons that really changed the trajectory of my life. Being in the cornfields of Allendale, you learn a couple things. One important thing I learned was how people see me and perceive me simply because I was black. It's not that I didn't understand our history. I certainly did. I understood, learned about the importance of our history, the civil rights movement. I knew all that. But I wasn't prepared for the microaggressions. I wasn't prepared for people to look at me and think that I was uneducated or that I got in a position because of some fluke. I wasn't prepared for people to look at me and assume that I had come from a background in which I just happened to not, and make judgments about me and my intelligence because of that perception. So there was a gentleman who stayed across the hallway from one of my good friends, and we would hang out and talk sometimes. And one day he puts a bandana over his mouth and he says, "Look, I'm from Detroit," as a joke. That was kind of the first time where I was really taken aback about, because that's layered, right? Very layered. And believe me, we scheduled a conversation for the very next day to talk about why that was not okay, because he really didn't know. But it really made me stop and think. Why do you think this behavior is okay? Why do you think it's funny? Where did you get that perception of people from? So it just made me start to think about how people view me in the world. Another thing happened. I worked with AmeriCorps, and I was a volunteer with Grand Rapids Public Schools, a mentoring program. And one day, a little girl runs up to me, a little girl that looks like me, and she says, Miss Kyra, can girls go to college?" And I stopped. I was really taken aback. I mean, she ran up to me. This was important. And I said, "Of course. I'm a girl. I'm in college. I go to college down the street, as a matter of fact." And she turned to the little girl next to her and said, "See, I told you." So these two little girls that looked like me were having a conversation about whether or not they could go to college as a young woman. But the people in this room know they weren't just having a conversation about whether or not they could go to college. They were having a conversation about what they could and could not be. Because we know that a lot of things that we want to be require a college degree. Now, I'm not saying that college is for everyone, but you should certainly know that you can if you want to. And in that moment, I was able to be a representation for those two little girls. Again, I had taken for granted, probably before that moment, the importance of representation. But then I realized how powerful it was, because it's really hard to be what you cannot see. And that's why this position on the Michigan Supreme Court matters. So people ask me all the time, what does it mean to be a black woman on the Michigan Supreme Court? And that is a very layered question. But for me, it means representation. It means that little boys and little girls can look up and say, "Maybe I can do it too." So, but it wasn't a smooth path there. So I'll tell a little bit more about my story. The third thing that happened in college, I had the great fortune of having my great-grandmother with me until the end of college, my senior year. Now, I got my degree in psychology because we weren't going to start over. But I knew I did not want to be a psychologist. So for the youth in the room, it's okay to not have it all figured out. So I was talking to my great-grandmother, and she was getting up in age, and of course she would start telling stories about what was going on in the neighborhood, and I was always a listening ear. "Please tell me what Mabel was doing today. I want to know." She would just look out of the window and then just tell me everyone's business, and I loved it. And then she would share recipes and other things with me. And then she shared with me the story of my great-grandfather. And many of you have heard this story if you know who I am. But for those that don't, my great-grandfather, Jesse Lee Bond, was lynched in Tennessee in 1939 after asking a store owner for a receipt. And he was beaten and thrown into the local river. And the coroner deemed it an accidental drowning. And as a result of that determination by the coroner, his murderers were acquitted. So in hearing that, and I've always had a very strong sense of justice. I mean, my favorite phrase growing up was, "That's not fair. Just ask my mother." But in hearing that, it really changed the trajectory of my life, because we hear about Jim Crow, we hear about slavery, we hear about the injustice that has occurred, and sometimes, especially people my age and especially younger, can think that that was so long ago. This is my great-grandfather, and again, I'm talking to my great-grandmother. So after talking to my mentors and other people, my parents, I decided to go to law school because I wanted people to see justice in a way that my family didn't see justice. And I wanted to make sure I was an advocate for those individuals. So I went to law school. I was eventually barred after spending 3 years at University of Detroit Mercy School of Law. And I did criminal defense work in my community, which really helped me understand the criminal justice system. I then became a judicial law clerk with the Honorable Judge John A. Murphy in Wayne County Third Circuit Court. And one thing that's not in the bio, which I probably should, he's the longest serving African American judge in the state of Michigan's history. So I have been blessed to have wonderful Black mentorship and leaders, and he really did mentor me, and I'm so thankful for that. He never treated me as if I was a mentee or a staffer. We would have robust, honest discussions about the law, and he valued my opinion, and that meant the world to me. And so if you know someone that's, you know, if you're mentoring somebody, I really just encourage you to really lift that person up and let them thrive underneath you. There are so many people that take on the mentor role but don't want people to surpass them. I'm just going to be honest. And I'm fortunate because, and I will tell a full circle moment of why that's important. I then went to go work for Lewis and Monday because one of my mentors that I had with the Wolverine Bar Association, she texted me one day and she said, "Hey, we have a position open as an associate, would you be interested?" And I very unprofessionally, "Don't do this," said, "Yes!" But she was my friend. And I said, "I'm very sorry, that was so unprofessional. Where might I send my resume?" So I worked for Lewis and Monday for a couple years doing civil litigation. And then when you see things in the law, and those that are attorneys and judges know, sometimes you see things happening in the law over and over and over. And you're just like, if I could just fix this one thing, things would work so much better. I didn't know I was going to be that person. And about 2 years of practicing litigation, someone asked me to run for state representative. And of course I said, no. What? I'm at a law firm. I am, you know, I have clients. I'm working hard. I want to become partner. And then the request came again. I want you to run for Michigan House of Representatives, representing your hometown of Southfield. I said no about four times. I'll spare you all the conversations. I finally said yes because I started to think, who better than me? Who loves my community more than me? I can't think of anyone. Who has the knowledge and the intellect to actually change the laws so that they work better for the people of the state of Michigan, other than someone that has seen them in practice? And so I'm not going to say that confidence came easily. It did not. But evaluating the circumstances, I just got to a point and I just said, why not me? Why not me? And you know what? Let's let the voters decide if it's me or not. And if it's not, that's fine. But let's give people options. So I ran for state representative, having never run for office before. I didn't know I was going to have five opponents. So all the self-doubt seeps in. Am I good enough? Am I ready? Because in that race, too, was my sitting state senator who had just termed out of the Senate representing my community. Should I get out? Is it my turn? Is it my time? And people told me directly, it is not your turn and it is not your time and you are too young. Start with school board. You're too inexperienced. And I had to ask God, if this is what I'm supposed to be doing, why is all this backlash coming my way? But there was a reason for it. Because I won my primary with 45% of the vote against 5 opponents. And I appreciate the hand claps. I say that because I outworked everyone in my race. I was outraced, but I will never be outworked. So I served in the legislature for 4 years, and I was able to get 5 bills passed into law while serving in the minority. Senator McDonald Rivet doesn't know what that's like. Representative Amos O'Neill knows what that's like. So I was very fortunate to be very successful in the legislature. So in June of 2021, my Congresswoman, Brenda Lawrence, called me to her private residence in Southfield. You see, she obviously represented me in Congress, but I represented her as her state representative. So when I got a call that said, you need to come to my house on a Sunday at 3 o'clock, I was scared. I'm thinking, what did I do to reach the level of a congresswoman to come to her residence on a Sunday? I think you all don't. If a congressperson wants to spend their personal time with you on a weekend, it can go one of two ways. I'm just saying, I don't know. I didn't know which way it was going to go. So we have tea and crumpets. She has it all laid out for me. She asked me, how old are you? And I said, 34, okay. Writes it down. She said, where have you practiced? I tell her, she writes it down. She said, okay. How long have you been in the legislature? You voted for me, I don't know. Okay, and I said, finally said, Congresswoman, what is this about? She said, have you ever considered running for Michigan Supreme Court? Have I? Sure, maybe, I don't know, 20 years from now would be great. She said, no, next year. I said, oh no, Congresswoman, not next year. I don't know if you know, but I just told you, I'm 34 years old. I was in the legislature. I'm getting bills passed. I'm helping the community. I got $1 million of appropriation to my community. I'm rocking it out. No. So she just looked at me as any auntie would, disappointed, shaking her head. Usually don't want to disappoint a congressperson, but I just was not in that headspace. And I wanted to start a family. And I had a miscarriage in 2019, and I suffered from uterine fibroids, which I know a lot of women in this room do because it affects black women 80% more than other races. And so I was not sure of my reproductive viability. So in thinking about having a child, I didn't want to be running a statewide race. So I did get pregnant. And of course, I'm in my first trimester, nobody knows. And I'm very, very sensitive because I know what it's like to lose life. So someone else asked me, are you running for Michigan Supreme Court? What? No, who said that? So every time someone asks me, no, I'm not. I'm in the legislature. I'm getting bills passed. I'm getting money to my community. I'm saying this over and over again. Finally, I got asked so much, I had to start telling people I was pregnant. I said, but please keep it to yourself. Please. 2 weeks later, I got another round of phone calls. Congrats, we heard you're pregnant. We still want you to run for Michigan Supreme Court. So then I started thinking about not just me, but what this means for Michigan. What this means for my daughter to have representation on the highest court in the state of Michigan. What it means for her generation and the generation after, because what we want to always celebrate Black history, let me be clear, because of the progress we've made. But I will be happy the day when we tell somebody, this person's on the Michigan Supreme Court, this person's president, this person's vice president, this person's governor, never been a Black woman governor in the United States history, but that is usual, that is regular, that it's unremarkable for us to be in positions of power. So I decided to run for Michigan Supreme Court because I wanted to see that representation myself, and I wanted my daughter and her potential children and all of your children to have that representation. You know, I had gotten my adult life without seeing that type of representation, and everybody in this room that are adults have as well. It stops here. The buck stops here because we have representation now. So many of you may or may not know, when I decided to run, I was running in a race that had two incumbents. So I knew that there was a high likelihood that I wouldn't win. It's very, very hard to win in a race where there are incumbents, right? But the representation, someone daring to try, someone having the nerve to challenge the status quo, is what was important to me. So in running, I gave up my job in the legislature because you can't run at the same time, but I still was serving. So at one point, I was pregnant, running a statewide race while having a full-time job in the legislature. Did not miss one day of votes in the legislature. Had my baby in August, which is in the middle of the campaign, and I accepted my nomination 6 days after I gave birth. Thank you for the claps. Don't do that. Don't do that. Don't do that. But representation was that important to me, that in my most vulnerable state, I put myself out there to make sure that we had a future, that we had justice for generations to come. And so it's funny because a lot of people think I won that race. I did not. I gave you all my firstborn and I still didn't win. No, I'm just joking. I'm joking. I did lose that race. The two incumbents won. But one thing happened that I was not anticipating. Chief Justice Bridget Mary McCormick stepped down. So I'm here to tell you, youth, what's for you is for you. Now, I didn't win the race, but if I did not run that race, I would not have been in a position to then be appointed by the governor. So running the race put me in the position to be appointed. So I didn't win, but I came within 2 percentage points of second place. 1.3 million votes across the state of Michigan. And I'm so thankful for that because, I mean, election night was hard. It was hard. But I was instantly uplifted when I saw the numbers come in, because when you look at your ballot, it's just little old Kyra Harris Bolden. There's no incumbency designation. There's nothing that says state rep. That means 1.3 million people went to their ballot, saw my name, and bubbled me in. And I was instantly uplifted. What you all may not know, and I'm almost done. Right, I'm almost done, which means I'm not. No. What a lot of people don't know is the governor doesn't just call you one day if you want to be a judge, right? If you're appointed. There's an appointments process. There is about a 100-page application. You have to go through multiple rounds of interviews, get recommendation letters. It's a very intense process. So at one point, I had a full-time job in the legislature, had a 2-month-old, going through the appointments process. There's one more thing. Maybe that's it. Still running a statewide race. That's it. Still running a statewide race. So when I was informed that I would receive the appointment, I was obviously very relieved. And I think publicly you all kind of saw that happening. And then I had the opportunity to swear in the governor at the inauguration. Since then, I've been able to author 3 majority opinions. One has been, thank you. One was unanimous, which means all the judges signed on, or justices signed on. And we've been doing really, really great work. But if there's anything to take away from this story was, I forgot the full circle moment. Remember I told you I ran for state rep, people said, you're too young, you're too inexperienced, you're too this, you're too that. And I said, God, why? If I'm supposed to be in this position, why is there so much opposition? And that's because when I ran for Michigan Supreme Court, I needed that experience for me not to be deterred. Because all of those same things were said to me when I ran for Michigan Supreme Court. You're too young. She's too black. You're too inexperienced. Is she pregnant? But I was able to shut out all the noise because of the experiences that God gave me. And I'm just so thankful. I'm thankful and honored for all of the trials that I went through that helped build me enough to even have the audacity to run. Because again, if I didn't run, I wouldn't have been in the position to be appointed. And so I just want to share with you here. The Michigan Supreme Court is the last stop for so many people. Determining whether people get a new trial or not, whether someone loses their children or not, some of the biggest issues that face our communities in Michigan will come to the Michigan Supreme Court. But what I can say is I carry you with me every day when I'm making decisions. And I'm going to continue to make good decisions as long as you continue to allow me to serve. And I just want to say thank you so much for allowing me to be a vessel to make history in the state of Michigan. Thank you for your support. Thank you for showing up. And I will continue to show up for you. That is why I'm here. We have to show up for each other. So happy Black History Month. And I thank you so, so much for giving me the opportunity to share my story with you today. Thank you.
Come on, Saginaw and Saginaw County, help me celebrate the first African American woman in
the highest court in the state of Michigan. She is a wonderful person. Come on, you can do better than that. Help me celebrate her. We thank God for this amazing woman. As we celebrate God's goodness and his faithfulness to us, we are honored and overjoyed to have you in the great city of Saginaw. And just what you spoke about, we thank God for your position, but it's more than your position. Your presence of showing up, making sure that your voice is heard. But not only that, you have passion. You have a passion and a zeal to make sure that things are connected together and you never have forgotten where you've come from. You talked about honoring today. And Romans 12 and 10 says that we should outdo one another in showing honor. But not only in your passion that you have, but since you got personality. You're easy to talk to and just, you make it easy and comfortable. And so we must respect that your personality came out today and just being honest and open and transparent. But you're a woman of poise as well. And so we celebrate you and thank God for you that you're willing to push others forward and to make sure that the shoulders that you stand on, never forgetting where you've come from, talking about your mother in the back and your family. And we thank God for your husband, who is also a dentist as well. Amen. Come on, help me celebrate on today. On today, we want to present this to you. We want to present this to you on behalf of Victorious Believers Ministries, and it's a little heavy, all righty, but we want to celebrate you for the quality work that you're doing, the representation of your voice to the community, to the state at large. And if people only understood the responsibility and the level of what you carry, you said 34 years of age?
I'm
35 now, all right, you got to admit it. Come on, help me, family and friends, celebrate justice. Come on, Kyra Harris Bolden, who is with us on today. Come on, you can do better than that. Help me celebrate her. She's a tremendous woman of God. And so we honor you and celebrate you. What a joy it is. In the year of 2021, we had our Black History speaker. You may be seated. We're all going home in the next few minutes. And his name was Dr. Vincent Oriolo. And so that was in 2021 was Dr. Pamela Pugh. And then 2021 was Dr. Vincent Oriolo. I'm getting these years mixed up. I know in 2023 was our president of the Saginaw Valley State University was Dr. George Grand, and he is here. Seems like our last four previous speakers are with us on today. And so we are honored for all of the wonderful people who have gathered with us on today. I want to acknowledge them. And thank God for each and every one of them. And so as I do so, in no particular order, our own, he's a family member, and so we celebrate him, but we always recognize the one and only Honorable Judge M.T. Thompson. Amen. Come on, help me celebrate him. He's a hard worker. He's always thinking. Come on, he's always passing on. He's an author. And so all the stories that we told, I can't say it all, but you'll get a chance to hear even more. 1972 was a pivotal year for him. But how God has moved and impressed upon his life to still be in the forefront of our city. And so we say thank you. The Honorable Judge Trice was trying to make it on today. He was not able to make it. But all these other judges who are here with us. Is Judge Borrello here? Andre Borrello? I didn't see him. Was he here? Okay, all right. I want to acknowledge those. Judge Gaffke, Honorable Judge Julie Gaffke, she just stepped out, and so she's newly appointed, so we celebrate her. Come on, help me, if you will. And so we thank God for Judge Janae Lamar is with us on today. We celebrate her. She's a one. Come on, stand up, sis. We thank God she's doing so much in our community. Attorney Glennis Talley, who announced on today, she is a new partner in Southfield, just made that. She's a product of Victorious Believers Ministry. She was served on our board of directors. All righty, and so we celebrate her. I mentioned Dr. George Grant, the president of Saginaw Valley State University. Amen. We celebrate and honor him doing a wonderful job. Our state representative, Amos O'Neill. Come on, help me celebrate him. That's my brother. That's my brother. Thank God for his hard work. I mentioned the president of the State Board of Education, Dr. Pamela Pugh. She had to step out on today. And our senator, Senator Kristen McDonald-Rivet, doing an excellent job. She's no stranger to our ministry and to this wonderful community. Her partner in life is Lady Rosa Holiday. We celebrate her. And what can I say about the president of the Saginaw Board of Education, our own? Come on, help me celebrate. Come on, Dr. Coleman, who is with us today. And to all the dignitaries, let me keep going while I'm on a roll. Help me celebrate young Julian Morris. All righty, that's a dignitary. Come on, stand up, young man. He's doing such a remarkable job, and I thank God for him. And to all of you who have come on today, I pray that you were tremendously blessed, inspired. You learned a lot. I learned not even knowing that our song was birthed out of poetry. And now we sing it as our Black National Anthem. What a joy it is to Saginaw United, to Saginaw High. Let's continue to pray for our school. Amen. There's no rivalry. Well, at the end of the year, we have a couple big basketball games. Let's keep it honest. Amen. But I've been praying that the merger, as it's going to go very well, I want to share with you as adults, it's our responsibility to make sure that happens. You hear me? It's our responsibility. Those who are adults, I know that you graduated from Saginaw High. I know that you graduated from Arthur Hill. But it's our responsibility to speak life into this. It's our responsibility to pray for those, to make sure that it comes off well. And it's going to be a great success. And so today, as we continue to pray and to believe God, this is what our church on a regular basis does, is to pray for our wonderful community that God is going to continue to bless. He's going to bring new jobs and doors of opportunity that no man can shut. Anybody believe that on today? And so as Justice Bolden has shared with us on today, I pray that you will not allow anybody to create your world. Because as she said it from her version, listen, they're always created too small. And so God has given us the authority, knowing that eyes haven't seen, ears haven't heard, neither has it entered in the heart of man what God has in store. But you'll never accomplish anything if you don't get started. Come on, it may take a little step, but just take that step and you see what has happened and how she has grown and matriculated to the highest court in the state of Michigan. Help me celebrate this young vessel, anointed woman, full of passion, zeal, purpose, destiny. Come on, help me one more time. I hope you understand what we have. 100 years from now, we'll be talking about this young lady and the contributions that she has already made. As we're departing, I cannot leave without celebrating the Christian Education Department of Victorious Believers Ministries. Come on, help me celebrate Sister Sharon Buffalo, who is a phenomenal work for Dow. She retired. And so I want to celebrate her and her team. Come on, you want to say something? I need you to come to the mic. Sister Sharon Buffalo, outstanding, outstanding, outstanding job. You have a new vice president that's working with you, Sister Dorothy Nickelberry. Come on, Sister Nickelberry, stand. We thank God for you. But this team has worked so, so hard. Help me. I'm big on this. I never want anybody to celebrate people who come from outside. But I just believe that we should celebrate our own more than we celebrate people who have come all the way from a foreign territory. Amen. Help me celebrate this woman of God who loves God and has done an outstanding job.
Thank you, everyone. My name is Sharon Buffalo, and I won't be with you too long because I know it's after 5. I do want to give honor to Pastor and Lady K for giving us the opportunity, us meaning Christian Education, to be able to facilitate this program. I enjoyed myself thoroughly, and I hope everyone did as well. I do want to give some thank yous to all of the, first of all, to Justice, I want to make sure I get it right, so I'm going to look at my paper, I'm going to cheat. Justice Kyra Bolden, thank you so much. I was so blessed by your story. I am not from the U.S., I'm from one of the Caribbean islands, but I do have 3 children that are Black Americans. So I consider myself as one of you because I've had to raise 3 children and teach them to walk as well. I want to thank the Saginaw High School, all the judges and dignitaries. Thank you so much for coming. It was so good to have you. I really do appreciate you being a part of this celebration. And to the Saginaw High School and the Arthur Hill, the drum line, they did an amazing job, and the step team. And to our retired librarian for this amazing poem, that, and how she, you know, everyone I asked before the program is, do you know anything about your history before slavery? And the answer was always no. So we thought it was an opportunity to educate everyone that we did have a life prior to slavery, right? A good life, a wealthy life. And we still are living in Africa as kings and queens. So it's very important. Education is very important. All of the program participants and the MC, thank you so much. But I would like the committee to please stand, the Black History Planning Committee. I couldn't have done this without you. So please stand. They were all diligent. I couldn't have worked with a better team. It's not about me. It was a team effort, and that's what we do. We work together and to produce what we have today. So again, thank you so much for your time. May God bless each and every one of you. And again, thank you.
Praise God, Sister Buffalo. Hats off to the entire team. I love hearing that accent. Amen. All the way from St. Lucia. All righty. Well, to God be the glory. We celebrate each other. Let's continue to push each other forward, not down. My parents always taught me, if you're looking down at someone, you should be helping them up. And so we carry that same heartbeat to make sure as we carry things out. I'm going to ask the former Honorable Judge M.T. Thompson if he'll make his way at this time. I want him just to share with a couple minutes. I do want you to know something called the Freedom Schools of Saginaw. Amen. I just thought about it. And so we celebrate that this is a six-week program that will be housed in a couple of our, three of our churches. I praise God for Bethel AME Church. I thank God for New Life Baptist Church, as well as Victorious Believers Ministries. For 6 weeks, we're going to be imparting in our children. We're not going against any school district. This is in the summertime for 6 weeks that our children will learn more about life and culture. They'll learn so much about, they'll be singing, they'll be going on different field trips. And so I want you, if you want your child to be involved, as a matter of fact, we're raising finances now to support this. It costs over $150,000 for us, but I am grateful for our executive director, Sister Dr. Candace Thomas, who will be leading the charge. I'm grateful that Minister Copeland will be one of the overseers as well, Sister Lula Woodard from our church as well, and also Reverend Lafoon from Bethel AME. So it's going to be a wonderful program. You're going to hear more about the Freedom Schools of Saginaw. We thank God for Mr. McNair and their foundation that is helping. But we need your support as a community. So when you hear about the Saginaw Freedom Schools, you'll know and learn more about it. You're going to be hearing about it on radio stations. But we're blessed that this is happening in the city of Saginaw. It's been in Flint for years, but we're bringing the Freedom Schools to Saginaw. So we're grateful on today. The Honorable Judge M.T. Thompson, please, if you will, if you'll close us out and share some very important things as God has placed upon your heart. God bless you. And again, thank you so much for being with us on today.
Good afternoon. First, Rhonda, we are an African people, and I'm an African. There's a beating of the drums in our community tonight. Do you hear the beating of the drums? I'll probably hear them for the next 2 weeks. But there's a beating of the drums in our community tonight. The drums are calling for justice. From every corner of our community, from the graves of our forefathers to the coming world of our children, there's a beating of the drums in our community, and they're calling for justice. There can be no justice without judges who understand and care about us. Justice Kyra Bolden is running for judge. We need judges who have a sense of mercy, judges who will apply the law impartially. There's a beating of the drums in our community tonight, and they're calling for justice. We have a chance. We have a choice. If we march forward in lockstep to the same drummer, we can elect our first black female judge. There's a beating of the drums in our community tonight. Do you hear the beating of the judge? We have a chance. We have a choice. You can vote for your children's future. Do you hear the beating of the drums? If you hear the beating of the drums, then march to the polls and vote for our first black female judge, Judge Bolden. Thank you. Lord, we come now thanking you for this opportunity. We thank you for this special worship experience. We stand on the very cutting edge of history. Give us the strength and determination to step forward and make the right choices at the poll. We pray for your mercy and for your traveling grace as we leave this place and return to our individual homes. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Well, thank you.
Amen. Ladies, I want you to come up to stage as well. Any young ladies?
Victorious believers, and we stand.
And we stand.
Yeah.